The December 5th, 2016 meeting of the Methacton School District Board of School Directors is now called to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hi, my name is Sophia Scott, and this is my last year at Audubon. I thought I would tell you some of my favorite things about it. The first thing is we have an awesome police officer that comes to our school at lunch and to teach us lessons. His name is Officer Barber. We also have a really nice orchestra and band program and awesome teachers, Miss Shuey and Mrs. Chapman. We have a full-time working nurse, Mrs. McDonald. She has a cure for almost anything. We have a really nice principal, Mrs. Brucker. Even though this is her first time here, she treats everyone like a family. And last but not least, Mr. Castleberry. He is the funniest recess aide I've ever had. He is also very patient with kids. Having all these people makes Audubon Elementary School an awesome place to be part of every day.
Good evening, everybody. We have several meetings tonight. Our first meeting is the reorganization meeting of the board that happens on an annual basis. Is there any public comment on the agenda items of the for the reorganization of the board? Okay. Do I have any nominations for temporary president?
I'd like to nominate Brenda Hackett.
All those in favor? All right, Brenda is now the
The first order of business is to ask for nominations for the role of president. Would someone like to make a nomination? Ms. Reese?
I nominate Chris Boardman.
Do we have a second to that nomination? Ms. Larsenese? Do I have any other nominations for president? I'll ask for a motion to close the nominations for president. Mr. Winters? Second? Mr. Boardman? All those in favor? So we have one nomination on the table. All those in favor of Chris Boardman for president for 1 year? Okay, yes. Make it unanimous. Chris Boardman will take over as president for a term of 1 year.
Thank you. Will, do we have a nomination for a vice president? Yes.
I'd like to nominate Brenda Hackett.
Second?
I second that.
Any other nominations? Yeah.
I'd like to nominate Mike Ryan.
Second. Okay, we have two nominations on the table for this, with the nominations of Brenda Hackett and Michael Ryan on the table. I'll call the election at this point.
I make a motion to close the nominations.
Okay. Second, all those in favor? Here we go.
Chris, you might want the secretary to do a roll.
So we'll just do a roll call vote, and when I call your name, just state who you would like for the candidate for the vice president. So I'll start with you, Mr. Reese.
I think both would be excellent choices, but keep status quo. I'm going to vote for Mike Ryan.
Okay.
I vote for Brenda Hackett.
I vote for Michael Ryan.
I vote for Brenda Hackett.
Jim?
Brenda Hackett.
Okay. Mike Ryan.
Michael Ryan.
And I'll vote for
Brenda Hackett.
Sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off. And I'll vote for Michael Ryan to keep things the same. All right.
You should announce it's a 5-4 vote in favor of Mr. Ryan.
And we have a 5-4 vote in favor of Mr. Ryan. That's all. May I have a motion to adjourn the meeting? Second. All those in favor? All right. We're done with the first meeting. That is the fastest meeting I've ever ran, so no, Brenda's meeting was a bit shorter.
Call to order.
Yeah, let me see here. I'd like to call to order the work session and regular board combined meeting for December 5th, 2016. We'll all rise for the Pledge of Allegiance for this meeting. The public is hereby advised of the audio-video recording of this meeting for the purpose of rebroadcasting. We also have two executive sessions announcements. There was an executive session of the board held in the Farina Admin Building on November 30th for the purposes of contract negotiation discussions regarding the Methacton Education Association, the Methacton Education Support Professional Association, and the Teamsters. There was an executive session of the board held in the high school prior to this board meeting on 12/5/2016 for the purpose of discussing two student settlement agreements as outlined in tonight's agenda. By way of attendance, we have all the board members present, and I'd like to turn over to Dr. Zerbe for recognition of guests and scheduled speakers.
Thank you, Mr. President. This evening we have three presentations. Is Audubon home and school? We're gonna ask that. Do you have something to show on the screen? You know, we ask that the Audubon Home and School Association present first. If you want to come down front, that'd be most appropriate. And then we have two other presentations that will require you to take seats in the front row. Audubon Home and School Association.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Dr. Zerbe. My name is Jen Stevenson, and I am co-president of Audubon Home and School. Apologies, I didn't have slides. It's just been a busy time, and I wanted to keep it brief. I'm speaking tonight on behalf of all the parents who contribute to Audubon Home and School. They do a lot of great things. So first of all, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you this evening. And I also thank you for your service, the board, to the Methacton School District. You know, as a fellow volunteer, I totally understand the huge time commitment you're making as a board member. Our organization exists to enhance the educational needs of the students of Audubon Elementary beyond what the district supports, and also to provide community community-building events between parents and teachers. We raise about $25,000 a year for the students, and you've probably heard about some of these events, but some of the things that we do are to provide support for back-to-school night, the kindergarten first grade meet and greet, the walkathon, homecoming parade, family fun night where we basically host an event for families and students, the Mothers on Bowling event, the winter solstice, which is coming up this weekend, December 9th, the book distribution. We give every student in our school a book, compliments of home and school. We support Staff Appreciation Week, Family Fun Day at the Reading Phillies, where we donate, you know, some small amount of funds for each family to spend. We host a variety show, father-daughter dance, two cultural events for the school, like we might bring in the Franklin Institute for the students, the Fun Fair, fourth grade events where we host a community building event for the fourth graders, and a fourth grade outing in May of 2017. These are some of the many things that we do to support the school. Additionally, there's so many things we also fund, and I'm proud to say that we make a donation to Post Prom, which is a wonderful event, the bus driver appreciation lunch. We pay for all the busing for class trips. We give each teacher, and this is in accordance with school board policy, $50 for anything they need for the kids, like tissues or whatever comes up that they need. We provide water for the school in case of any emergency. We make a contribution to the chorus, the band, for supporting the school shirts that they buy. We have a student help fund. We pay for so many things that probably people don't realize, the student planners, and we also have a mini grant program so that anytime Mrs. Brucker needs some kind of support, whatever it may be, we bring it to one of our meetings, and most of the time it's able to be approved because we do such a great job at raising funds. So on behalf of Audubon Home and School, thanks for the opportunity to speak to you. We do have a big event coming up this Friday. It's our winter solstice event. It's a great event. It's a silent auction event. It's got lots of holiday fun things for the kids, plus silent auction baskets and raffles and all kinds of different things. So that's our big thing that we're working on this week. So thanks again, and we appreciate all your hard work.
Thank you so much. Your list could have gone on for another, you know, 15, 20 minutes, and the challenge is that, you know, I don't think our schools would be the same without our home and schools. So Audubon being, you know, a prime example of the work that our parents do in their volunteerism. So I want to thank the Audubon Home and School as well as the efforts of the entire Methacton community and for supporting our schools the way they do. It makes it a much better place. So thank you. Two other presentations here this evening, the SRO recommendation and program planning and capacity. Please take your seats in the front row, and we'll do those presentations. I will ask, since both of those are likely to be presentations that will require questions, we'll do a presentation, we'll come back to the seats, take questions, and then flip back and forth. I don't typically do that, but with the light agenda, I think we have time to do that this evening.
Hey guys.
Good
Mike Clicker.
Is it? Oh, excuse me. Let's see it. All right, fantastic. Well, good evening. Tonight I will provide you with an update to the School Resource Officer Project, as well as make a recommendation to contract with a vendor for full-time SRO and security services as identified throughout this program. First, we'd like to remind the board and community of our efforts to date related to this project. Starting in August of this year, we began to identify our programmatic needs and preferred future of the SRO program. We presented those items to the board at the October 18th work session meeting. The board then advised us to initiate the solicitation process to identify potential vendors. On November 1st, we issued the RFI and gathered vendor solicitations. We then progressed to coordinating vendor presentations and reference checking. On November 22nd, we presented our findings to the board and gained authorization to move forward with securing a contract with a single private provider for the program design option that included two full-time officers and augmented services. Finally, we conducted site visits and follow-up interviews with each of the two vendors. In addition, requested the district solicitor to begin preparing a contract. What you'll see on this slide is that it highlights the criteria each vendor was evaluated on to ensure the vendor selected would be the most appropriate for our district. All the items listed are key elements to the overall program success. With that said, we are recommending U.S. Security Care to fulfill the program design. They have been providing security services since 1996 and are located in Bluebell, Pennsylvania, with other corporate offices in other states. One important note is that the U.S. Security Care has been approved by the PDE Office of Safe Schools as an approved school police officer vendor. As a reminder, the recommended program design shown is the same structure we presented at the last board meeting of two armed full-time school resource officers to include the following items. In addition, the augmented services for the high school and Arcola Skyview campuses were also a part of that design. The program cost structure for this program design is estimated at an annual cost of $150,000, $150,491, inclusive of the vehicles for the SRO and all elements listed. In conclusion, on tonight's agenda, the action item is as follows. To authorize the administration to contract with U.S. Security Care of Bluebell, Pennsylvania for armed school resource officer services and security services for a period to begin February 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2019 with the structure and rates as presented and pending review by the district solicitor. And at that time, at this time, that concludes my presentation. And I think we would like to adjourn you back to your seats for follow-up questions.
The first thing, are there questions from the board? There are? Then we would go to our seats.
Yeah. I'd be shocked.
All right, why don't we start down at this end. Any questions?
Questions.
I have two, or one's a comment, one's a question. now being here 1 year sitting at this table, there always seems to be financial surprises. So when I look at this cost analysis, is there any, are we missing it? Like, you guys did a great job, by the way. Thank you for bringing all of this to us. But I look at that number and I think, okay, every time we approve a number, then a couple months later, for different things, most of the time I know it's something different. But could there be any, what additional costs might pop up? Is there anything that might pop up?
Sure. Let's take an example that we wanted this SRO to provide a service above and beyond the 190 days as outlined here. At that point, it would be an hourly rate cost as defined on the cost schedule. The augmented services, we've estimated them to be accurate relative to the known events at the high school and Art Cola Skyview. So we believe that to be a reasonable approximation of what we could expect to pay. But yeah, because again, our security needs might change based on the year and event, I think there might be a little bit of ebb and flow, but I think what you're seeing, what I could suggest is that what you see here is a pretty good representation of what the annual cost would be.
And the only other question I had, it was minor, it's just I went and looked, you guys did all the legwork, but I just went and did a little bit of looking since I'm here to make this decision. And I was wondering if, and I might say his name wrong, that John Gooley was still with the company.
He is, and actually he's sitting up in the audience.
I wasn't sure.
And if he could wave. Thank you.
Good to know. Thank you.
So I had a question last time when you presented about the experience of the company selected concerning being a school resource officer. And if I recall, neither of the companies that we talked about have actually done that but have similar history. Can you tell us about this company?
Yeah, so U.S. Security Care has public school experience. But they have much more private school experience, and I'm being honest with that. They have a bigger footprint in a private school place. But one thing, it's important to note that the candidates for the SROs that we'll solicit and hire through this company will be retired municipal and state police officers. And in that capacity, these men and women have a lifetime of experience in dealing with issues relative to public schools. We believe that their experience relative to security, the designation that they received through PDE and PDE's Office of Safe Schools evaluating their program speaks volumes to the quality of what is presented tonight for Methacton. So we feel confident that they have ample experience to provide any of the services that we have identified in that RFI.
So we are at a stage of having used an SRO program, which was originally funded by a larger government than we are, in order to scope this out as a way of having a more effective safety situation within public schools. And so to shift from this model that we have had and go to another one, I don't have a problem with going to another one as long as I know that our students will be just as well advanced and protected and secure as they have been.
Can I speak to that? They will have a commensurate SRO program where they'll have two full-time officers, one in each of the campuses, but with the flexibility now to go to any of our schools because there's no jurisdiction requirement where we can only service potentially, a school in high school in Worcester. With that said, we are gaining a significant level of augmented services and security presence. Significant security presence through those augmented services we can now afford, through this program, and then have it all managed under one umbrella to have program consistency, communication flow between all individuals, and just an overall better approach to the safety and security piece for Methacton schools. Welcome.
Couple quick things. You mentioned one of the criteria for selecting the vendors. One of the criteria was consistency of personnel.
Yep.
Could you describe, you know, what kind of went into that and how you evaluated it based off of that?
Sure. So consistency of personnel was a very important piece for us. Let me describe what we didn't want to have happen. We didn't want a pool of individuals rotating through our schools. It's important for our students to build rapport with individuals that are stationed here. It's important for that same rapport to be extended to the administration, you know, to the faculty. They'll learn the ins and outs of our school, our district. In every sense of the word, they will be Methactenized. Because we want them to be a part of us. We see this to be a partnership more as just a vendor relationship. So it was important for us to make sure that through this process, we had significant input into the selection process of the individuals that would come on, and then also that those individuals would be primarily stationed here at Methacton, and then not be able to be pulled for other duties or details that company might have. With that said, we also wanted to ensure that, you know, from time to time people like to take a vacation day, but we had an adequate backup that we also vetted out that would be in place of that individual if that person cannot, you know, come to work for that day. So we feel very comfortable with the hiring process and the commitment to the consistency of personnel that U.S. Security Care is going to provide us.
As part of that, did you look at their turnover rate of their own employees? And as you know, one of the things that we want to make sure is if we select that right individual who will fit Methacton, that you know there's not a high frequency of turnovers, that they could be here for a year and then next year, you know, they might have moved on to something.
Yeah, that's a really good question. We didn't feel it to be appropriate in the sense that that they're new to the school resource officer program, right? So we're not able to evaluate turnover on a program that's, you know, really in infancy of its establishment here in public schools. That's something we could follow up and get information on relative to their security services, most definitely.
Okay. And you kind of touched on it with, I think probably the most important part of this is going to be the selection of the individuals who are in this. So I just, you know, I really hope that is a well thought out and a very detailed hiring process, that we find the right person who's best for us, because I think that it all comes down to the individual. I mean, whether it's a Lower Providence police officer or if it's a, you know, one of the employees of this company, that it's all about the person who we bring in, the relationship that they can build with the students, with the faculty, with the administration. I think that's really important. And the other thing, which you touched on in the presentation quickly, and I think it's important because I tried to do a little quick vetting of the company on my own, is the mention of the PDE and how they were selected as the safe school provider. You know, the Pennsylvania Department of Education has come out and said that this company is capable of providing this service. They've selected them. They've vetted them thoroughly, too. So it's a added layer of protection, not protection for us, but, you know, it's a second layer of vetting, which I think is very important to point out.
Yeah, it reassures the quality of their program.
So, all right, thank you.
All right. I'll try to be brief, but I might not be. On your evaluation criteria, you have eight points that you referenced. I'm sure you looked at some other ones. But did you put a scoring matrix together, and do you have that?
We did for the initial interviews for the presentations, and it used this this scoring matrix. There were three vendors, as you mentioned, and then two were passed forward. After that, we did not leverage a matrix per se. We then evaluated them on the site visits and follow-up references and some of the other pieces, such as the safe school office approval.
Mm-hmm. Is it possible to get that initial matrix scoring?
Sure.
Okay. Just as a reference, I guess we're voting for this tonight. So I just, as a follow-up, I'd like to see that.
Yeah,
I don't think
it would
sway my
decision.
I would just like to see how they scored out. And, you know, obviously I would be looking at where did they score lower and what are we going to do to make sure that goes up. I mean, that's kind of the reason that I would want to see it, not for any other reason. On the hiring process, I know I think I said something the last time, but who's going to be involved in that hiring process, Troy?
So it would be similar to the committee that was used to help evaluate the company. So it would be representation from building principals, Dr. Harney from the HR side of things, myself from the district safety perspective, and then obviously U.S. Security Care, relative to starting to identify individuals that would closely match the criteria that we provide them.
Okay. And just one word of caution, and Frank, this might go to you. I think I said it last time. We've got to be very careful if we're involved in the employment interview process that we don't get into a co-employment issue. We're contracting for services, and I don't know how law varies from state to state, but I would be somewhat concerned if we formally call it we're part of the interviewing process versus, how do we say that correctly, that we don't get in a legal bind at some point in time that somebody can come back and say, you were part of that interviewing process and whatnot. So I just think we've got to make sure that we've got a script to make sure we're not stepping over a boundary that we really don't want to step by, that somebody can claim pension and those kinds of things at a later date.
Yeah, I understand your concerns with respect to that. I think you've done a couple of things so far, and we'll make sure that that's the case in my interaction with them. But I think we've done a couple of things so far. They are not an employee of the local police department, nor are they an employee of the school district. And that is the reason for the SRO designation as opposed to another designation, as I understand it. Is that correct?
That's accurate.
And so we've certainly taken that step to ensure that. And then in addition to that, we'll make sure that the language is articulated in the appropriate way.
Yep. Okay.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
I also think it's great that we have this PDE certification. I don't know what all goes into that certification, but I'm assuming it's fairly robust. But is there a recertification process that you go through annually, every couple years? Mm-hmm. And I would think that we want to get kind of notification when that's going and see the results of that. When it's done.
Yeah, I asked that same question of the company, and there is no known recertification once your program right now has been approved. It seems to be approved in perpetuity, but that would be a conversation I'd like to have with the director of Safe Schools office at PDE and say, what does this look like in the long term? Because this designation really has just come around in the last 3 years or so. So I don't know if they're forward thinking in terms of a recertification process as schools change, as the needs of these officers change, to change that certification evaluation process. But it's definitely a conversation we'd like to have with that director.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. I mean, God forbid they do a great job here and they're laying an egg somewhere else that could eventually cause problems at our place. I would think that recertification process would surface those issues. Mm-hmm. So, I do think that's worth a follow-up conversation. Did we ever come up with the total current cost? I know we were about $300K with the Lower Providence, but I thought we were going to do some research with what do we pay in augmented services or ad hoc services now, and I don't remember ever seeing a total number.
The estimation for this 16-17 school year per Dr. Spiewak is approximately $20,000 for services rendered for varsity sports and other events at the high school.
Just at the high school, but nothing does Arcola Skyview do anything?
And that's the point. They don't right now. So
okay.
Part of this program
so it's enhanced services.
Exactly.
There. Got it. Okay. Last two questions. Is there enough time to efficiently and effectively transition from Lower Providence to the new supplier by February 1st, I think you said?
Yes, when we did our site visit, U.S. Security Care presented us a very professional and realistic timeline for what a transition would look like from our current program to a U.S. Security Care provider program, and we believe that we can definitely get that up and running at the timeline set forth right now. With that said, I know that Dr. Zerbe has reached out to the township and Chief Turtle to gain some insight whether or not if we needed additional month or so on our current contract with Lower Providence Township Police, that they would be gracious enough to extend that offer to us and allow us to go on a month-to-month basis. That way we have the smoothest transition possible.
Right. Obviously, we want to get it done sooner rather than later, yep. But you want to do that. And my guess is you want the new employees on board to do a complete transition. There's probably some administrative transition that can occur at the management level, but I would also think there's some localized transition at the individual SRO level.
Yeah, that's all accurate. Okay. And that's why we look to see potentially if we could extend, if need be, that month to give that additional transition time.
Okay. And their transition plan has a timeline that's, you know, got some toll gates so that we can make sure we're staying up with it.
Yes, and it would meet the current contracted deadline of the end of January.
End of January. Okay. And last but not least, it probably goes without saying, but I'm assuming, Dr. Zerbe, that you endorse this recommendation, since it's on the agenda, but I have to ask anyhow.
Yeah, this is my recommendation.
I wanted Brenda to ask that. I figured that I was not doing it justice if I didn't ask the question. All right.
Brenda, you're still allowed to do the victory lap. Good evening, Troy. a few questions. One is, it seems like we weighted a lot of things on this PDE standard. What are the standards, first off? Could you provide us with the standards?
Yeah, so what we'll do as part of the follow-up, we can provide you with what the criteria that PDE, Office of Safe Schools, evaluates vendors on that.
And you're saying this certification was in the last 3 years they came up with this?
They received it, U.S. Security Care, and I'm going to look to my left, in 2014, if I'm accurate, approximately. And the certification helped me. How long has it been as part of the Office of Safe Schools? My current understanding, it's approximately, I want to say, 3 to 4 years.
3 years.
Thank you.
Did Lower Providence have this certification through PDE?
They have it, no, but I think they're different because they are already a local law enforcement agent, and I'll let Frank speak for that.
That's exactly right. They're not required to. They're a police department.
Yeah. Are these companies required to have this, to perform this service in school districts?
No, they're not required to have it to perform this in school districts.
So what... other than PDE, you know, filing the application, which, you know, I'd like a copy of the application. I'd like to see all the information that it takes to get certified through them, being that we're waiting this so much on the decision or your recommendation, I should say, because I haven't decided yet.
So let me add some clarity to that. So, again, that was one key piece. The two vendors were in different stages in this program design. Although both vendors that we reviewed were very commensurate in terms of service and pricing, as we mentioned in previous board meetings, the delineation was that U.S. Security Care presented us with a developed program that was vetted by PDE's Office of Safe Schools, where the other vendor, although equally qualified, was in a stage of developing it and pursuing that same PDE approval. So the maturity of the program was a key factor in this decision-making process.
So in that program, how's that differ from what they're currently doing and what PDE specifies.
I'm not clear as to your question.
Well, you're saying PDE has a specified program. I imagine it has certain elements and procedures and stuff like that. So you have one company with the certification. So what makes it different with the company that doesn't have it? Like,
I can't speak to the other company and where they are in the process and what pieces they were missing that would prevent them from successfully applying and obtaining approval from PDE.
Was the other company willing to comply and get that certification?
Yeah, they stated that to us and gave us and said that, you know, they initiated the application process some time ago, decided that it wasn't in their best interest to continue with that process, abandoned it at that time, and then started to explore more into this area and work with us. They said they would be willing to relook at that piece and then develop the necessary elements that would allow for them to be PDE certified, as we identified here.
The this company, you say they have a Blue Bell office. How long have they been in Blue Bell?
I'll look to my left. 20 years.
Okay, and that's their head office. Who's the principal that owns?
Mr. Wolfson.
Now, when you say principal, is he just the CEO? Who is the major, the majority owner?
He is the president and owner of the company.
No other people?
No.
As far as the schools that they do carry, the public schools that they have done, which ones were they?
The public school that they provided experience for was Springfield Township School District, right here in our neighboring Montgomery County, and they provided security services for them from September of 2009 to June 2010.
Okay, what was Springfield's what was their answers to your questions when you inquired about their services?
Right, so they were not listed as on the reference list that we had, and so we did not touch base with Springfield. But all of the references that we did touch base on, in addition to the ones they provided, we reached out to our own county agents and contacts in Montgomery County, safety offices, and everything came back stellar reports of their professionalism and program and services relative to schools.
But fully vetting somebody, wouldn't you think like a flag would be they're there for a year, maybe a little over a year?
No, because it was for a specific assignment for a situation that warranted additional security presence for that time. I did ask that.
Okay, and how'd they perform? What was the cost? Were they on budget? What?
Again, if you would like, I can follow up with Springfield Township, my counterpart there as well, but again, I think that the vetting that we've done to this date is more than adequate and speaks volumes, and not just my own vetting. Again, PDE has vetted them extensively to provide this designation, and to point out they are only one of four vendors in the entire state that has this designation assigned to them currently. So it's not something that is just handed out because you're a security agency in Pennsylvania. You have to have a whole curriculum, a whole program designed specifically for offering programs and services within a school environment.
One of four people in the state that, and you have your other vendor that you interviewed that abandoned the process. So it starts to make me wonder whether or not the process was worth it for other companies, first off. Second, being 2-3 years into it, you know, I just, not knowing enough about that program and not knowing enough about what their standards are, there's no recertification, it doesn't sound, it sounds like, well, we get to put this logo on our letterhead that we have it. One issue I have here, I appreciate the recommendation from the administration, but the big factor here is I have to vote on this. I have to vote on people being in this school that are armed, that we pay. So we have a budget issue, we have a life safety issue, and I have to fully vet it. And it's great that you're standing here telling us. I'd rather interview both companies. It's not like we have 5, 6, 7, 8 different companies that we're trying to weed through. We're down to 2. And I'd like to have that opportunity to ask them questions sitting there at the microphone rather than getting it secondhand, third hand. And I'm not going to vote for this, in favor of this tonight, because this is something that I got to put my name to. And considering that it's a life safety issue with armed guards, I want to interview them as a full board. And I think every board member here should take responsibility and want to be able to meet these people, their principal, the owner of the company, et cetera, so we can, without any question, say that we fully vetted and had every opportunity to ask the questions that we need to feel comfortable with our decision. And I'll leave it at that.
I just have a couple of questions that haven't been addressed yet. So the state reporting of incidents with the Safe Schools report, that's mandated by the state, so I'm assuming that their requirements are the same as what we currently have with Lower Providence.
Yeah, there are requirements, and we're responsible for providing that information to PDE. So their requirements would be the same.
Okay, and do they offer any additional reporting or information or data that they provide back to us beyond what's required by the state?
Yeah, so that's what's part of the quality assurance of the program. One of the great flexibility or benefits to this program is that we will get a site supervisor assigned to us that is constantly on top of these individuals to make sure that they meet all of the standards that they put forward and we put forward as wanting in this individual. So not only will we have input into the overall interactions and quality of work that these individuals were providing us, but on top of that, we have an additional layer of supervision to ensure that program meets the highest quality of standard that we've defined.
And one final question is, do we have the option at any point in this process of requesting that the guards not be armed or the officers not be armed? I know with Lower Providence, that was non-negotiable.
It's certainly our recommendation here this evening, as Mr. Sosnovic and our evaluation team is recommending that we carry forward the program and its structure as it exists today, which our officers are armed. However, it is at the will of the board to make that decision. So if it so chooses to do so, it can recommend that they not be armed.
I guess my question was more, does this company allow for their SROs to not be armed?
Yes.
They okay. will, but it's at the same rate as an armed. Yep.
Just, I'll be real brief. From this firm, can we get a copy of their operating agreement, also their list of president, vice president, all the principals, and their operating agreement for their corporation?
Okay. Thanks, Troy, and the rest of the committee. I just have a few follow-up questions, some good questions already. First of all, I just want to make a comment towards Lower Providence, and I think everybody up here, just not speaking for everybody, would want to thank Lower Providence Police for outstanding services over the years, especially the impact of Officer Barber in the elementary school being the first thing that's spoken to about the night. So this conversation is not related to Lower Providence. The the service is already provided by our local police. The one concern I have and is the intelligence sharing with the Lower Providence, and we talked about this briefly a few weeks ago with the question, but I think the one of the main things is that connection point, and I think Lower Providence will provide that support to whichever vendor we have. So it's more of a comment, I guess, than unless you want something to speak towards that.
If you would feel a little reassured, as part of the transition process and establishment of this program, there will be an addendum created with each Lower Providence Township Police and also the State Police to provide the one information that, hey, we have individuals that are acting in this capacity, and then what those roles and responsibilities are, and then communication, and then what that workflow would look like would be part of that right. MOU addendum.
Yeah, it's a different partnership, but still a partnership with the local police. From aspect of the takeaway is there is actually increased coverage from an hourly perspective, just to highlight that. The one offset to that is it sounds like there's not summer coverage at the high school. Is that true?
Again, this contract allows us to have the flexibility to offer that or acquire that through this same agreement, if so desired, but it would be an additional cost as presented.
It's not presented that way. The other thing.
Let me just say this too. Some of the coverage listed here is for varsity events that are taking place during the summer. So I just want to make that clear. But
yeah, you know, having somebody during the administration time in the summer is not necessary. Is one less service that will be provided to the school district.
Less service because it's currently not being provided now during the summer.
So there's no, okay, so it's only the 190 days that Lower Providence is providing the high school also?
No, go ahead.
Lower Providence is on duty for the period of time that our students are in session. And so that is approximately 181 days. And that's the contract that we have with Lower Providence. So currently right now, there is no summer assistance other than our typical call of local law enforcement if there's an incident on the property.
This
will be a similar situation.
Is Lower Providence providing in-service state protection or not?
No.
Before you get off that point, let me just highlight. There's 181 student days.
Yep.
So out of 100, we estimated 190. So what that provides us with is some period of time that we might want to pull that individual in over the summer to review our emergency management procedure as we do every year annually. Give us that input and stuff. So we estimated some summer coverage, but it would be more for procedural updates and preparing for the upcoming school year as opposed to providing any type of, you know, security or safety service, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I'm glad I asked because I assumed it was related to the working days of the MEA. So that is not the case, the 190. So the flexibility of adding or subtracting from that perspective, it's really around just having an additional 9 days to use as is.
That's correct.
Okay. I think that's it. The last one is the pragmatic needs. So one of the first things that in the current contract with the Lower Providence is work with the school personnel in providing alcohol and drug education, problem-solving resources, et cetera. Are those services included in this?
Yeah, again, that RFI listed those type of services, and these individuals would be able to provide those services. In addition to that, we also gain in the sense that Lower Providence has offered to provide us with a community policing officer too, no matter what happens with this program moving forward. And that individual can come in and help augment some of the programmatic needs too, because we still feel it very important to maintain a strong working relationship and partnership with our Lower Providence Police Department.
Okay, very good. I just last comment again, I want to thank, because it's a very touchy issue, and I appreciate the professionalism of you and your team to look at it in the administration, because it's not an easy decision. I don't think anybody here wants to go backwards on safety, so thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I guess I get to finish it up, huh? So most of the questions I had were answered, which is cool. A couple quick questions. What schools do they service currently in the area?
Do you want to speak to that?
My name is Chris Springfield, the Vice President at Head U.S. Security Care. Christo Ray High School in Philadelphia, and we do three other private schools in the Philadelphia and Lower Merion area. So Poets, Hebrew Academy, and Kohelet Yeshiva in Lower Merion.
Okay, so there are no public schools that you've done, that you're currently servicing? Correct?
They're not currently servicing any public schools.
And you used to, brief contract with Springfield Township for basically 1 year, it looks like, a one-year contract.
Yeah, for one school year.
Which kind of surprised me, because Springfield Township has their own police department, so I imagine their SROs may run out of there now. I don't know.
Yeah, well, no, again, that was for a very specific role. For security services for a situation that had cropped up at that particular moment in time.
Okay.
They evaluated companies throughout the area, and then U.S. Security Care was able to quickly provide them with those services when approached.
So any of those schools that you mentioned, like Hebrew Academy or anything, I guess are nowhere in size comparison to what Methacton is, I would say.
That is accurate.
Okay, so we're asking them then to pick up two relatively large campuses with a high school population and the Arcola Skyview population. So I guess I have a little concern about that they would be able to, that they're up for the task of doing that with nothing in their resume of saying, yes, we've handled public schools, we've done this, this, and this, and this. Okay, so my last question is with the other vendor that we looked at. I believe they had and are currently servicing some public schools in the area?
That's correct.
Happer Horsham, possibly?
Yes, for
Lower Merion?
For varsity sports events and other related security services.
Okay. And we chose this vendor primarily, from what I'm gathering in conversation, because of that PDE certification.
That is not correct. That's partially correct.
Okay.
The reason why we chose this vendor was the maturity of their overall school police officer program.
Okay.
It's a completely different program than just providing a security guard for a varsity event. This is an individual that needs to know how to not only, meet all the criteria set forth by MOPEC, which is the Municipal Police Training Commission that oversees, Act 120 certification, Act 235, and all of that. But in addition, obtain the knowledge and training to work inside schools, how to deal with students with disabilities, how to work with students of various different age levels, how to work with administration and faculty. These are all key elements to that what they would provide to us regarding that individual. So
okay.
Again, they have this developed program that met all of those programmatic needs.
Did the other vendor have any of those programs with any of the other public school districts?
No.
Okay, so basically the other public school districts were basically using them as security for maybe special events or athletic events or whatever.
That's correct.
So really they were not providing a true SRO program like we have had.
They were not providing any SRO program in any school, public or private.
And this firm has got that program, curriculum, etc., and is willing to develop it and work with Methacton to even create something that we may need customized, I guess, depending on what our needs are here.
Yes, and the flexibility, again, was a major component to this company. Again, no one district is a cookie-cutter type scenario. the problems and issues and environment and buildings and students and everything else that comprises Methacton School District is unique to Methacton School District. So it was important for us to be able to find a company that would be flexible in meeting what Methacton needs.
Okay. And last question I had, and you may have said this before, and I don't remember, but for instance, the new program we get, the new SRO program we're developing here with U.S. Security Care, for instance, are they going to be able to go to Worcester, you know, with like, and rotate into a different school, elementary schools?
Both SROs would have full flexibility to go to any of the schools within our district.
And develop the same relationships that we have?
Develop all the same relationships.
Okay.
And all of that.
Cool. That's it.
Thank you.
Now, Herb, you said you were going to be last. Do you mind if I go?
I'm just paying you back.
Start over there.
All right. I don't have any questions. I think all the questions to answer. I'd like to reiterate, you know, I appreciate all the work that the team put in. You came well prepared. You answered a lot of very detailed questions, and I know it was a lot of work and appreciate that the team put into that. Thank
My
you.
Pleasure. I closed my folder, Brenda. I put my
Sorry.
Papers away.
Sorry.
That's okay.
And listening to everybody, it seemed to me that there was one other thing that I wondered about, and that is that what we currently have is a police officer who is part of a police department, therefore is supervised by police professionals who are up to date on changes that happen within society, within our area, and so forth, and that the police officers have a prescribed regimen of training as time goes on, and that may be in excess of what is required for an Act 120 officer to keep certification. And I wondered what type of training these officers might have.
Yep. And what I'll do is, I'm glad I opened my folder because I have it all listed right here. So they go through not only developmental training at the onset, but there's continuing training throughout this entire program. In addition, they have to continually meet various certifications. To maintain their certifications, they have to go through certain training. So they group their trainings into three specific categories: orientation training, which would be customer service, mandatory appearance guidelines, CPR first aid, use of force, report writing. They go into their law enforcement curriculum, which is school bomb threats, handcuffing certifications, defensive tactics, constitutional authority, authority and justification, verbal de-escalation, active shooter prevention and response procedures. I'm skipping over some bullets so I don't bore you. Then going into the more important one, which would be school-specific curriculum, and that, again, that comes into that piece that was so important to us. Emergency response procedures, interacting with children and adolescents, role of the SPO, RSO, confidentiality, behavioral and threat assessment, dealing with students who have disabilities, PA mandatory discretionary reporting. It speaks to Kim's point about the safe schools and making sure the report that we have to submit to PDE at the end of the year. And then in addition to the above, and I'll just read this verbatim, in addition to the above, all armed officers receive quarterly firearm training using the National Rifle Association Law Enforcement Division approved zero misqualification course that exceeds the Pennsylvania MOAC standards for a sworn police officer. So why I read that is that they are getting above and beyond training that even our Lower Providence Township Police would be getting relative to firearm certification and all of that.
If I could just to add on to that, not just firearms, but other societal changes that happen, which the police would typically get. I think most of the things, it seemed to me that you said, are things that we would expect the person to come with. But as things change, we know we do it for everybody, that they get education.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and again, that's important to us as it is you, and those individuals we believe would be getting that. And again, I highlighted the key elements of their training. But my contention, as I look to Mr. Ghouli in a stand, as he shakes his head yes, that those individuals would have that level of exposure and training as well throughout this program.
Okay, if there aren't any other questions.
What could you name those all the schools that the other company services as far as public schools?
They do not serve any currently.
No, the other firm, not this one that we're voting on tonight, but the other one.
I do not have an exhaustive list, but what I shared with the board at the last session was that I believe I mentioned Neshaminy, I believe I mentioned Hatboro Horsham, and Cheltenham School District, those three.
Okay. You know, the board's putting a lot of trust in the administration and you to vet these guys out. The other company, have they ever done any work for Methacton School District?
Echelon has not provided, well, I will say that as part of our graduation commencement services, they volunteered their services at no cost to the district for just graduation, and that's the only service that I'm aware of that Echelon has ever provided the school district.
Okay, so, you know, I'd like to know more of what they've done for the school district. You see, knowing the whole picture of who we're hiring is very important in this. Just like I asked for the corporate docs and the operating agreement within that corporation that I want to see, just like knowing or not knowing or not being told from the administration that one of the other vendors did work for Methacton at one time, because that raises a lot of other questions of what Methacton's experience was with them. Did we have issues with them? Why, like, it brings a lot of questions. So now I doubt the information that I get because it was not brought to us in the beginning.
Sure, it's because they never worked or contracted with Methacton for any services. The services rendered was provided to Methacton because the individual who's the principal owner of the other company lives in Methacton and extended that service to us just out of a sight of goodwill. Again, Echelon has never provided any services for Methacton School District.
If there's not any other questions, we have a second presentation. Dr. Angstad, I appreciate if everyone could take their seats in the front row.
Is that going down? You're putting it.
Yeah. Good evening. Tonight, I would like to share with you our review of our Skyview, Arcola, and Methacton High School programs. Based on a request that was made at the November 15th board meeting, the building administrators and I met to review our educational programs in their schools. The review consisted of the following: identifying the special education programs, pupil services, and other regular education supports provided in our upper elementary and secondary schools, determining the required or most appropriate space to deliver the supports and services identified, verifying the total number of homeroom eligible spaces available in each school, and by homeroom eligible, it was our terminology we used at the elementary level. It really looks like a full-size classroom. We counted the total number of small group and office spaces available in each school building, and we calculated the total number of spaces needed to effectively implement our existing programs, services, and supports based on Chapter 14 regulations and best practices. As I previously mentioned at the elementary review, Chapter 14 regulations require that each special education class is maintained as close as appropriate to the ebb and flow of usual school activities, located where noise will not interfere with instruction, located only in a space that is designed for the purpose of instruction. It needs to be readily accessible and composed of at least 28 square feet per student. In addition, pupil services and regular education supports adhere to best practices. In addition, we reviewed other dedicated spaces, and there's two important things that I would like to point out. If I can click the button. At Skyview, the current spaces used for gym, art, music, library, computer lab, science lab, or tech ed remained the same, and I will be sharing this with you on the charts when we go through each school. Another important note is that at Arcola and Methacton High School, some of the dedicated spaces that are listed, such as art, music, and science labs, serve as homerooms from a capacity evaluation standpoint. It's also important to note that the capacity calculations also take into consideration scheduling and room utilization by period. So unlike the elementary schools where students are basically in the room all day long, here you need to look at scheduling and the number of periods per day in order to look at your capacity calculations. So again, I used the same format as I did for the elementary school when I listed this, although all of these charts have one added column called dedicated spaces. And I apologize for the small font, but I was trying to fit it all on one page for you. So we looked at homeroom eligible spaces, which consisted of regular ed classes, our learning support, autistic support, and communications class at Skyview. We currently have two gifted education classes, a reading specialist in a full-size room, and a media center classroom. We found that we could share one homeroom eligible space, which again is taking a full room and putting a physical divider between it, for ESL services and math support, and that the following people could use a small group space. That would be our emotional support teacher, the math support teacher, speech and language therapist, the occupational therapist and physical therapist could share a space, and our mental health specialist has a small space, and there's two school psychologists currently at Skyview, and they could also share an office, or a small group space, sorry. In terms of office spaces, we have an instruction and intervention specialist, two school counselors, the nurse, and special ed supervisor. And then in terms of dedicated spaces, as I mentioned earlier, we looked at the gymnasium, the art rooms, the music rooms, the library, science labs, the tech ed classroom, and computer labs. And so you could get a better idea of how much open space there is. We looked at the total number of homeroom eligible spaces, which was 53. We took the numbers from the first page, which was 31 regular ed classrooms, 14 special ed pupil services or regular ed service classrooms, one shared space to come up with a total of 46. Subtracting that from the total, we would have 7 homeroom eligible spaces open. In addition, we have 13 dedicated spaces. We have a total of 8 small spaces available, and we need a total of 6. And office spaces, I believe that looks like an 8 from this angle, and we have 5 that we need. And that's the summary of Skyview. We did the same thing at Arcola. We walked through each of the buildings. We counted all our spaces. We needed a total of 46 homeroom eligible spaces for regular ed, world language, science labs, learning support, and autistic support. Our homeroom eligible shared classroom consisted of two gifted teachers sharing a larger room. small group spaces for emotional support, ESL, speech and language, and a shared space for occupational therapy and physical therapy. And then we looked at office spaces, which was the mental health specialist and school psychologist, our school counselor, nurses, and our school resource officers. And then again, dedicated spaces. There's art rooms, music, library, tech ed, computer lab, family consumer science, the TV studio, and the planetarium. When you take all those numbers and you compare them, we had a total number of 49 homeroom eligible spaces. Our programs, when you added them up between homeroom eligible, special ed pupil services and regular services and the shared space, brought us to 47, allowing us to have two homeroom eligible spaces open. We have 16 dedicated spaces, a total of 6 small group spaces, 4 of which we would need for our program, and there are 5 office spaces available, and we needed 5 office spaces. I should mention that the main office is not counted in any of these calculations. And again, when we're looking at that total eligible homeroom eligible spaces open, it's 2, but you need to keep in mind that capacity would also need to look at the scheduling and the room utilization by periods to determine the true amount of space available. And then similarly, we did the same thing at the high school. There are 53 regular ed classrooms, 17 science rooms slash labs, 4 learning support classrooms, 4 autistic support, life skills support classrooms, a prep for success class, gifted education, and testing center. We did not feel that any of those programs would benefit from being in a shared classroom space. In small group, we would be able to provide our ESL support. Office space would require the school resource officer, the mental health specialist, the speech OT and PT, an office for the school psychologist, and an office for our home and school visitor. And there are more dedicated spaces at the senior high. There is a counseling center which houses 6 counselors as well as 2.5 clerical staff or secretarial staff. The nurses, the CSR, the art rooms, the music rooms, the library, tech ed, robotics, the dance studio, family consumer science, the pools, and our gymnasiums. So when you look at the total, we had 81 total homeroom eligible spaces. We required 70 of those for homeroom and science labs. 11 are dedicated for special ed pupil services and regular ed services, and there are no shared spaces. And you will see that that equals 81 spaces, leaving a 0 in homeroom eligible spaces open. We had 21 dedicated spaces. We have 6 small group spaces and 1 small group space needed. And we had a total of 8 office spaces available, and 5 of them are needed. And again, although it reflects homeroom eligible spaces open as 0, you need to look at how the rooms are being utilized each period of the day and compare that with the scheduling to determine other space available for capacity purposes. And that's the end of the presentation. This presentation will be posted to the website for everyone to see tomorrow.
We also provided the same information to Mylon and Nick Broom.
Yes. Okay.
While it is true that we don't have physical documents of this data in front of the board at this time, We're certainly going to make printouts available to you and get those distributed to you for your review. I'm not certain if there are questions from the viewing of the information on the screen, but we certainly can take them if there are any now, or we can reserve any questions on this matter for a time when you had more time to review the information. Certainly, you should know that we did share it with Mylone and McBroom, and we are continually having conversations with them, following up on their status. Are there questions on the information shared? If not, we'll get you those documents and we'll post them to the website. And I just want to thank all of our principals, including the elementary principals from the last meeting, as well as our secondary principals, for their time and commitment to helping Dr. Angstad with this process. I think we all learned a lot about counting rooms and looking at spaces, and it's kind of opened our eyes up to a couple of ways of maybe doing some things better. So it's been a good experience for all of us. Thank you. And that shall end the recognition of guests and scheduled speakers.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Zerbe. Let's move on to the reports. The first one up is finance. Mr. Ryan.
There's never new report on there is a finance meeting tomorrow night.
Well, that's quick. Now onto the property. Mr. Dorn.
No report. We haven't had our meeting for the month. We aren't having one this month, actually.
All right. Moving right along. The Education Committee, Ms. Reese.
Same.
Policy Committee?
Big surprise, no meeting this month.
Okay. IU?
The next meeting will be in January. I reported on the most recent meeting at our meeting in November.
Okay, thank you. Monco Tech?
I've got one. Actually, I attended the JOC meeting back on November 21st. I apologize. I could not be at the last board meeting where this report should have been given. Otherwise, I wouldn't have one. But there's one. Basically, the normal business was conducted. Just a couple things that Mike and his crew are looking at over there. Going from two sessions versus three sessions, they're trying to jockey that idea around, and there's so many things to consider about doing that. The bell schedule of sending schools, for instance. Social studies and phys ed classes are taken at the tech centers in some cases. There's a lot of different things, IEP requirements. So they're trying to gather all this data, and it's kind of like a big, huge jumble of data that they're trying to analyze to see if two sessions is better than three, or three is better than two, or whatever, which way to go. But another thing, under the superintendent's report, I found unique that the superintendents of the participating schools are trying to align their school calendars.
We're trying.
Yeah. And are trying to do this to a better job and to align with Act 80 and service days, et cetera. But as I pointed out at the meeting, it's like herding cats. It's nearly impossible. So good luck to that. And with that, I conclude my report. Thank you.
Thank you. And now on to the student board representatives.
Okay, so this week, literature, biology, and algebra keystones are happening for freshmen and sophomores. Also this month, on December 21st, is the Methacton Winter Concert, and also the elementary and middle schools are also having their concerts this month. And lastly, there's a food drive held this past month with donations from students and from the National Honor Society and Student Council.
Thank you. And now on to the communications, Ms. Lynch.
Hello. I am proud to report that two Methacton High School students, Jeremy Wang and Joshua Liu, reached the level of semifinalist in the prestigious Siemens competition. Jeremy and Joshua are among thousands of students who submitted innovative STEM research projects. And while the two will not continue in the competition, sadly, a banner has been delivered, and we are proud of Jeremy and Joshua, who represent the latest in a long line of students who bring a sense of Methacton pride through their ability to compete in the sciences on a national stage. A great testament to our schools, our teachers, our families, and of course our fine students. Also, as she mentioned, the holiday season is upon us, and we invite the community to attend any of our winter concerts, and a full schedule appears on our website. Thank you.
Thank you. Now the superintendent's report. Dr. Serby.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just have two matters. The first one, I just want to remind the public of the school consolidation planning timeline and other considerations. We'll be posting this information here tomorrow along with Dr. Angstad's report. But currently slated for January 10th, we expect Milo and McBroom to present some preliminary redistricting options. Their final report, as they've indicated, would be in early February. While we've been trying to get all these dates in for January, as you've heard me speak so many times about, based on everyone's schedule, it looks like February 6th would be then the final presentation and recommendations from Milone. So again, January 10th and then February 6th. There may be other need for meetings, et cetera, between there, but those are two of the scheduled meetings that I wanted to bring to the board and public's attention, and again, we'll post those up for a public review. And lastly, I just want to wish everyone, because this is the last meeting for the year, I want to wish everyone the very best this holiday season.
All right, thank you, Dr. Zerbe. Now, do we have any public comment on the board action items?
Okay, before I forget, I want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. I'm going to be on, you know, TC and a Happy New Year. I'm just a little disappointed you have no other meetings scheduled between now and John, you know, regular school board meetings. As far as the SRO program, all the questions that were brought up tonight should have been a work session, and all this discussed, and you should have voted on this next week, and they get everything out there. My only question on the SRO, where the contract is concerned, is there an exit clause, or is there things in place in case there's issues within the next 2 years? Because that hasn't been mentioned. Because I was just curious, because sometimes, you know.
The standard language that our solicitor uses as part of contracts with all vendors.
I mean, I ask because I am aware that most contracts do have exit clauses, but some people are not aware of that and might be a little stunned if they find out there's a reason. Tonight, you have two settlement agreements you're going to vote on, which is nice to see you're going to vote on. But what is the dollar amount for each one of the agreements? Because I did go back and look at past agendas over the years, and whenever they voted on settlement agreements, there was dollars amount, what they were settling for, so I shouldn't have to read it in the list of bills next month. So I was just curious why. Because this is taxpayers' money that's being paid to settle these lawsuits.
We had the same request. It may have been from you at the last agenda where we had a settlement agreement. So I did check with the solicitor to make sure that we were providing a consistent and thorough review. You should know that, as reported in the executive session report here this evening, there was an executive session held before this meeting, mm-hmm. and it referenced these two, the settlement agreements, on the agenda for this evening. So the board is apprised of all the details associated with the settlement agreement, and that is of the most critical nature for them making a decision here this evening. Secondly, we will remain being consistent to protect the information associated with these settlement agreements. However, if you shall need any additional information on those items, please make a right to know request, and then the proper redaction of the information that's not to be made available will be made, and you can have that information.
Okay, my question is, I'm not asking any information on the people involved in the lawsuit. I have sat in this room for the last 10 years and have watched the school boards in the past vote to settle lawsuits with the dollar amount. The dollar amount is not private because it will be on the list of bills come January or whenever the settlement is, unless you haven't decided on the amount. But the amount that is to be paid to settle the lawsuit is a public issue. I know this. I know someone that settled with Methacton. When they voted to settle that lawsuit, the dollar amount was in the agenda. We don't need to know what's involved with a student. They are under 18. That is confidential under the law. But the dollar amount is tax money. And if you're voting publicly, I don't see why I should have to put it in a right-to-know request. I never had to before. So, I mean, Mr. Bartle, maybe you could clear it up.
Sure.
I mean, I understand confidentiality when it comes to a minor. But the dollar amount is taxpayer money. And it's been made public in the past. It was brought up last month. There was a dollar amount paid to a law firm, which apparently was a settlement that wasn't brought up at the meeting. So the money is in the list of bills, unless it's a secret payment, which I highly doubt. So, I mean, I'm just saying, you know.
There's no secret payment.
Do you want me to respond?
Sure, go right ahead.
I'll be happy to respond. First of all, thank you for the question. Some of the issues that you raise are important. First of all, as Dr. Zerbe has indicated, there are no secret payments. You are correct that when the school district makes disbursements, it's reported on the list of bills, and you have access to that. Mm-hmm. So you can see that information. You probably also can compile that information in a given classification to use it as you wish, without reference to individual students, because obviously it's not listed by that. Now, here's the reason why we suggest to the school district that dollar amounts not be listed. Remember, there's people out there that are other than members of the general public who have access to certain information in the school district. And they are entitled to have certain information, such as some of the employees of the school district, mm-hmm. who may be working in the defense of a given case. Mm-hmm. They are entitled to know the information with respect to that case, what they're going to testify to, the attorney-client relationship that they have, etc., and all of that information. Because of their relationship to the district, they know of the student, who the student is, and the like. They know the identity mm-hmm. of the student.
Yeah.
Okay. Our advice is that we have two competing interests in these matters. Mm-hmm. First of all, we have the interest of public disclosure, and then at the same time, we have the interest of confidentiality with respect to the student. Mm-hmm. Our duty as a school district is to be confidential not only with respect to the general members of the public, but also to the people within the school district who are not entitled to certain information. If you, for example, settle a case and you tell someone that they are no longer needed to do certain things with regard to a certain case because that matter has been settled, and then you immediately put in the public record what the amount of settlement for a certain issue would be, mm-hmm. it's pretty clear that people can put the two of those things together that mm-hmm. should not have the ability to do that. So as a consequence, to make sure that the school district is taking care of its responsibility, not only with respect to the taxpayer under the right to know law, but also with respect to the student, with respect to the FERPA laws, for example, and other federal laws that have to do with special education, mm-hmm. and making sure that we take care of those duties with respect to student confidentiality, on which they must be at least equally vigilant to the public duty, we handle it in this fashion. And if you want that information, you will have the ability to get it, mm-hmm. but we do the best that we can to make sure that people cannot easily identify what the nature of that settlement is and for whom.
Oh,
that's
I understand that. I mean, that was a very simple answer. I understand that, you know, when you're talking monetary awards, that could create a problem for a family if it's made public. But I'm saying, you know, having seen it done in the past, maybe this should have been explained earlier why it wasn't in. I mean, I know majority, I guess 99.9% of the people don't look at the list of bills. But I mean, I understand maybe it's compared to somebody winning the lottery and they want to keep their prize money quiet because we know how some members of the public are.
I can only say to you that with respect to the matters that you're referring to, and some of them have been disclosed and some of them haven't, they have to be assessed on a case-by-case basis. And okay. Some of the matters that you're referring to, it may very well have been that there was no confidentiality concern
based upon where the case was, et cetera. I can't speak specifically with respect to any of them, but that's the analysis that has to go into the school district's decision with respect to these matters.
Yeah, because I know, I also know it's a number of the lawsuits that were settled in the past, your law firm wasn't the solicitors at the time. So, and it was a different law firm that did it. I'm just saying that, you know, it's done one way and all of a sudden it's done different. I mean, it's a very simple explanation. And, I mean, it just, you know, when you don't see, when you've seen it there for a long time and all of a sudden you don't see it there, you start to kind of wonder why. But I'm glad to see that you're publicly voting to settle the lawsuits. And I understand that you want to protect the parents and the student. I'm all for that.
Very good. Thank you.
John Andrews, Lower Providence. With respect to the SRO discussions of this evening, I'm curious as to what the number, total number of employees are for the U.S. Security Care and Echelon, the other competitor. You know, if these companies have been in business for 20 years, you know, maybe, you know, various services that they provide. You know, they might have 100 employees and, you know, have some depth of management associated with things that are perhaps quite, you know, nothing like SRO, but helpful.
It's about 200 employees. I think so. I can't push right now.
Okay. All right. All right.
I'm making fun of Frank for not being able to push the buttons, and I can't push them. Paybacks, okay. Huh? There's about 200 for the company.
Okay.
Mix of full-time and part-time.
Yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any others? Okay. Moving right along. We have the first item, the approve the board meeting minutes for the work session held on November 15th and the board meeting held on November 26th. May I have a motion to approve the board meetings? Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, thank you. Now on to the fiscal items. Mr. Klaus.
Good evening. As it pertains to fiscal items 9A, the list of bills, 9B, the treasurer's report, 9C, the budgetary transfers, these items for the months of November and December 2016 will be presented and provided in January at the respective board meeting. As it pertains to fiscal item 9D, the settlement agreements and release, which were mentioned earlier, board approval is requested relative to the two settlement agreements and releases as outlined in the board agenda.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Klaus. The two settlement agreements, the approve the settlement agreement and release for student number 171655 with special language of the terms and the settlement agreement drafted and approved by the district's solicitor. And number two, approve the settlement agreement and release for student number 190964 with special language of the terms and settlement agreement drafted and approved by the solicitor. May I have a motion to approve the settlement and release? Second. Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor? The motion passes. Thank you. On to personnel items, Dr. Harney.
We have two resignation classified for your approval this month. We have one classified employment. We have one administrative stipend for your approval. We have two additions to our classified substitute list. We have the approved list of volunteers. And that concludes my request for this month.
Thank you, Mr. Harney. May I have a motion to approve all personnel items as presented? Second. Any discussion? Sure.
Dr. Harney, why do we call it a stipend? Doesn't feel like a stipend, has a different connotation to me.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
Why do we call
it a stipend for Danielle Penza. It's really, it's not a stipend by the definition.
It's a one-time payment.
Okay.
So if we'd like to change the wording, we can do that. But it's a one-time payment for duties performed in the absence of a business, a director of business services.
So she did above and beyond. Absolutely. What she was. I just want to make it, the word stipend just doesn't feel right publicly.
Do we want to change the item?
I'd like to.
Want to put it as a bonus?
No.
Well, it's not a bonus. It's compensation.
One-time payment?
One-time payment.
One-time payment for additional services provided.
Yep, that's exactly what it'll be then.
One-time payment?
Approve a one-time payment in the amount of $4,500 for Danielle Penza for work completed during the absence of the Director of Business Services.
Work completed. Yeah, so it's over and above her.
Yeah, her. That's good.
Okay.
I just have one quick thing to say. It's not a question. It's just a public recognition for all the work that Danielle did when we didn't have a business director. I mean, she really did go above and beyond. So I just want to publicly thank her for all the work that she's done.
Okay. All those in favor? Okay. Thank you. Now on to curriculum and programs. Dr. Katona.
I do not have any items coming before the board this evening from curriculum.
Under item 12, policy, there are no items for first reading. However, for your approval this evening, there are seven items under the second reading. Policy 236, student assistance. Policy 248, unlawful harassment. 339, uncompensated leave. 347, workers' comp, return to work. 432, working periods. 440, student welfare. And 530, overtime.
Okay, may I have a motion to approve the second reading of the policies? Second? Any comment? Discussion? Okay. All those in favor? Against? Jim, was that?
I was favored.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Moving on to item number 13, Dr. Zerbe.
Under item number 13, I'm asking the board as part of our annual business in December to look at the 2017 board meeting schedule, and we're looking to approve that schedule. That schedule was provided in advance. Are there any questions or comments on the schedule?
Why don't we start with Scott?
Oh, we got more than one?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to note the January 9th property committee meeting that will precede the special meeting is going to start at 6. From thereafter, it'll be 6:30. But we need to give ourselves an hour to get in what we need to get in.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I would like to see if we consider adding one summer meeting for the committees, either in July or August, depending on which is most convenient for those committees, to keep some momentum going through the summer. And also, I would like to add December committee meetings also for the purpose of, again, from a year ago, not having those committee meetings coming new to the board. We will have an election next year. We may have four the same or four different or some subset of such in December next year. So the earlier that those committees can reconvene, I think it's the better. So I would suggest that we can vote on this as is, but consider adding those additional spots.
I think it should be noted for the board, as Mr. Winters has suggested, that we can add to these dates at any time, and I think we have, and we've changed dates from time to time. So for this, for example, the summer schedule, it might be easier as we get closer to summer to be able to predict whether or not a certain committee needs certain work to be done, and they have the availability within their schedules to have those meetings. That's just a recommendation, but certainly the board can choose how they want to address that.
To add to that, I'm planning on keeping the committees the same going into the year. So in the springtime, I would ask the the heads of each committee to use your own discretion on what you feel in the July-August timeframe. You know, if you feel your committee should meet in that timeframe, you know, work to get that on the schedule and communicate it. If you feel fine with not having it, I'll leave it up to your discretion. But let's get on deck for the end of the year, because if we do have some transition, it'd be a good idea to get new people up to speed. And if we have the same crew again, then, you know, we can decide whether we need that or not.
It's not just the, I just wanted the other, I'm not trying to make it just around the transition, but also just the principle of the preliminary budget in January, that just that time period of the criticality of the budget, especially on the financial side.
Yeah, I have one other thing. Brenda pointed it out. The actual property committee, when I was exchanging emails, we were talking about having it January 10th prior to the special meeting. Somehow this still says January 9th. That's what the 6 to 7 was. That was that flurry of emails that went back and forth.
So, just bear with me one second. So that, so we did review that request. While it is certainly capable of having a meeting, you know, we will be starting at 6 o'clock, ending at 7. In the meantime, we'll be having folks coming in from to a meeting that they wouldn't normally come to. And I just don't know if that's going to be appropriate for us to hold that meeting in such a short time frame. So I just don't think that, you know, with all the work that we need to do with the property committee, and we got a couple of things on the table.
I'm unavailable. That was the whole start of it for the 9th. So we won't have a meeting in December, and then I won't be there on the 9th. So if that's how you want to do it, that's fine. But that was my original thing. I was not available on the 9th.
Well, we can certainly, I think the other options were to move it to other weeks, but that's going to throw things out of sequence.
Right.
Another option would be to let the co-chair, but the vice chair, we'll call it, because each of the committees has a vice chair, and they can run the meeting if that's so the desire of the committee.
Yeah, it's not my preference, since it'll be 2 months since we've had a meeting. So
is there no other ninth to accommodate?
I would rather deal with other meeting happening. We've had that process before, where we had a policy, I think it was policy committee, prior to one of the meetings. And
I have one suggestion, if it helps. The education committee, and I know there's other people, but as the chair, if it's possible to switch, I'd be willing to switch, if that helps. From, we have a meeting on the 2nd. If you'd like to switch for the 9th, I know I can't make that decision, but I'm just putting that out there if it helps.
I appreciate that.
I know you might not have your calendar, and everybody else has to agree to it. We are a school that day.
I know I will not be able to attend that meeting. I'll be coming back from Tampa on the 2nd, yeah. So if you guys can have a quorum, then you can do it, but.
So the other option, so that we can vote on getting this calendar forward, we can vote on it with the caveat that the chairman of the property committee and the superintendent will finalize a date that will work for best of us. But I don't have all the details. You know, I don't
switch in.
That's the only thing I can suggest. I mean, if it is,
it's fine with me.
If it is, then an opportunity to make it work, we will do that. But we want to approve the calendar pending a final decision by the chairman and myself for that particular committee.
Okay. Thanks, Andrea, for offering that up. Maybe that will work. Appreciate it.
Are there any other questions?
I'd just like to make a comment that I like having the schedule the way it's listed, with the committees being the first or second or third date of the week. I think it's good for the public. I think it's good for the board. And I think is a good improvement to the way we've scheduled it in the last year or so. And I agree with Paul that December should not be frittered away simply because lots of us are busy.
Well, let's try to work those in, then.
Oh, well, when you say work those in, are we going to try to work something in for December to put on this? Or are we going to wait to at a later date to work December in once an election occurs?
I think there's enough interest in having those. Let's try to work those in now and get them on the calendar.
For all committees? Is that what we're talking about?
Yeah, let's try that.
Okay. I would suggest that we just table it for the time being and add it later on. I mean, I just wanted to get on the record.
I want to vote on this as is, but let's see what we can do.
I would suggest that the committee chairs and contact Dr. Zerbe and then warrant if it warrants even having the meeting.
Yeah.
So not just to have a meeting to have a meeting.
So we're approving the calendar
as is,
and pending the property chairman's and superintendent's review of the particular January 9th meeting. Other than that, there's no other changes. Okay.
At this time, correct. All right. May I have a motion to approve the board meeting schedule for 2017? Second. Any more discussion on it? All those in favor? Okay, we got that one done. Good.
The next item under 13 is the school resource officer recommendation. You heard this evening from Mr. Sosnovic. We're asking you to authorize the administration to contract with U.S. Security Care of Bluebell, Pennsylvania, for school resource officer services and security services for a period to begin February 1, 2017 through June 30, 2019, with the structure and rates as presented and pending review by district solicitor.
I make a motion that we table it, and if someone would second it and we can have that discussion, I'd appreciate it.
I'll second the motion.
Thank you. I think this is something that the board has to have a complete look at it. I think we should go through our own interview process, being that this is the face of the board in the schools, armed guards. I want to feel 100% comfortable with the people that we have in our schools. I would like to interview the people that did the interviews for those two companies to gain their knowledge and their thought and their thought process while they went through the interview with the two different companies. And then I'd like to also have the board then interview both companies so we know exactly who we're dealing with, who the face of that business is, how they're going to conduct business, so we're comfortable with it. We're the ones footing the bill. We're the ones putting these armed guys in the district. And I think there's a lot of questions that I have that weren't answered. And I feel that it's just something that's important enough that we should be looking at this and owning it. You know, currently, we're just taking a recommendation without even knowing what the other company said, or this company, how it even answered questions. So this is something that I think we should vet as a board better for our own information.
I want to agree with Mr. Phillips on one point, that this is an important decision. So there's no question about that. But I must tell you that the suggestion from the board member to do what is the work of the administration, my administration, and the work that my administration has done a thorough job and has answered every question that has come before you or before us. It would be completely improper for us to take the director's recommendation and use that as a sole purpose for tabling this matter. But maybe even to the more critical mass is we have an obligation that will expire at the end of January. That shouldn't be why you need to make a decision this evening. But you can't lose sight of the fact that all the homework was done. The people that are directly associated with this program, the two building principals that are directly connected with the existing program and that will be directly connected with the program and people to come forward, have been involved from the very beginning, along with Dr. Harney. And I must say that besides his personnel experience, he has law enforcement experience. And I relied heavily on the input from the group to provide this recommendation to the board this evening. This is my recommendation, and I would like you not to table this matter and to approve the matter as presented so that we can move forward with the important work of the district.
To add to that, the questions that Jim, you're raising and all that are about the process. We've all agreed to the process. It's all been communicated to us over months as to what the process is. So up until this point, we've agreed to what the process is. So now to come in at the 11th hour and say, you know, there's issues with the process.
For instance, the process was fine, but as we asked our questions tonight, and one that I asked was the list of schools of the service providers, you know, what public schools, okay? Then further asking, I find out that there was some work experience at Methacton, which was not even brought to the board's attention that we ever hired these guys before. And
we never hired them. They volunteered their services.
Well,
that's very different.
We're not sure 100% if that's accurate. And I say this because
the committee told us that's what in fact took place. They were volunteers that gave us their time.
So they never
were not hired.
This company never had, or any of its affiliates never had, people in our schools walk in the hallways. We were just told
paid contract.
We were just told that they helped out with some sporting events.
Graduation, yeah.
That was it.
Given that they're Methacton-based people, I imagine they walked our schools multiple times as members of the community.
So I find out, after you guys vote on this, that they had employees walking the halls here, providing a service as far as a security guard, you're going to be fine with your decision tonight? And if we find out that it was more than just graduation, who are we going to hold accountable, and what are we going to do about it?
We'll find out if we're comfortable with it when we vote on it.
So this is something that we'll just, you know, we won't worry about all the facts. We'll just vote on this regardless.
It sounds like you have information we're unaware of. Is there something you'd like to share with us, Mr. Phillips?
I think if we follow through a process of our own questions of these two groups and maybe the people that did the interviewing, we'd find out a lot more.
Well, so if we did find out that this company had employees in our schools at one time, that somehow it happened at a time that Mr. Sosnovic did not know about it, it was not something that came up in his research, what does that accomplish for us? What does that tell us? What light does that shed on our decision here?
A few things. One, how we handled having a security firm in the school district, whether we made bad decisions on hiring someone or how that company handled things within our school. I mean, there's knowledge to be, you ask one question, you get an answer, which may lead to two questions. And I just, caution making this decision tonight. And the other thing is, these guys were sitting back there. Why weren't they up here fielding our questions? And that's, I have a problem with that. Our contact with the people that we're going to spend almost 200 grand on, they didn't come up here and ask for the job. They didn't come up here and field questions from us. And I asked Troy for their corporate docs, their operating agreement. Yeah, Troy could say, oh, yeah, I'll get them. Well, they didn't agree to that. And I'd like to see them. I'd like to see who owns this company.
Jim, I appreciate that. And I did a little, not a lot, because I trust our administration. But over the weekend, I did a little work myself. That's why I asked about Mr. Gooley, who was sitting here. Mr. Gooley is a retired sergeant, captain of the Lower Marion Police Force. I wanted to ask him a bunch of questions, but I trusted that our administration already did that. I wanted to ask him about the experience he's had with all the Lower Marion schools, because I'm sure he's had a ton. And Lower Marion's community, being where it's located, being the affluence that's there, I was very comfortable with Mr. Gooley. That's why I looked. Now, when I went on Echelon site, I could tell immediately it was a very different company. Now, I stopped my research there because my job is to trust administration. Granted, you're absolutely right that we as a board have a responsibility to do our own work. But I think we as a board had our responsibility to ask for this chance to sit in before tonight. And although I don't like making decisions based on time-sensitive nature, and I do not have all the board experience that you have, you've been here many years, I'm wondering if all these questions were asked when we used a bus service, which is a huge, major responsibility.
Well, here's something.
I guess let's not get into the bus service and the history.
Well, I'm not getting into the bus service. I can care less about that at the moment.
Keep it on the appropriate topic.
If you knew what corporate docs meant, an operating agreement, you would, that as far as the face of who like shows up at the meeting and whose name's on the letterhead, that's the face of the company. That's doesn't tell you much, but what tells you a lot about the company is who the principals are in the corporate docs. And is there other corporations that own this company? Are there other people? Yeah, there's a president, but I want to know, is there a succession of entities that own this? Is there individuals? And I want to see that operating agreement. And the other thing is, if something horribly happens here where someone gets injured or killed, who do we go back on? Okay, yeah, it's great that they have insurance, but who does it all fall back on? So there's a lot of questions.
All right, let's move things along here.
Yeah, you must vote on the motion to table, and then it either goes up or down. If it if it goes up, then this is taken off the agenda for tonight. If it goes down, then you're back to the main motion.
Okay. Let's vote then. All those in favor of Jim's motion to table this? Two. All those against? The rest. It's voted down.
Let the record indicate that I believe it was Mr. Phillips and who was the other?
Mrs. Hackett.
That voted in favor of the table, and all others voted opposed.
Thanks for that.
I would like to add, if possible, or just make a mention of it again, that if Mr. Phillips is aware of any information he feels we need to know, to please share it. If not, that's fine, but I would like to request again, if you have any information you feel you need to share, please do it.
The motion.
For the motion.
Okay.
As it's presented here.
Okay.
Did you read the motion?
I did read the motion.
Okay. So may I have a motion to approve the authorization of the administration contract with the U.S. Security Care of Bluebell? Second? Any discussion?
Far as the contract, far as our exit end and their exit end, is there any penalties for getting out of the contract early? Can we get out of it for any reason that we want?
We're currently working with the solicitor's office to make the contract as favorable to the district in light of this project.
Okay.
So I can't tell you exactly because not only are we constructing it, but we also need, there's two parties that have to sign it. So we're working towards having, you know, we certainly will have an ability to get out of the agreement. We need to work on some of those other items, and that has not been finalized yet.
And prior to us voting on the contract, this is to authorize to have the solicitor create the document. Prior to voting on that document, Troy said he'd be able to get us the operating agreement and the corporate docs. So I would expect that we can have that prior to the vote on the contract?
No, the way this reads is it authorizes the administration to contract with U.S. Security Care, and then it says with the structure and rates as presented and pending review by the solicitor. It wouldn't require an additional vote by the board.
Okay, any other comment?
Frank, just to help, as a part of that process, you'll look at the incorporation documents, or will you guys take a glance at the documents and make sure they're in order, it's a legal entity, blah, 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 blah?
If we're given that information, we'll certainly do that.
It seems like we should make sure we do at least take a look at the, I'm not saying do an in-depth study on the corporation, but let's make sure they have their proper documentation as a corporation, list ownership, blah, 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 blah.
I will review what I'm provided. If I believe that that is insufficient, you'll be the first to know.
Good point, Scott. Any other comment?
I'm just trying to understand. I just want to make the comment that this is something that we've been talking about since February or January. I'm not sure exactly the starting point. We've talked about this several times. I've gone back and forth personally on this thing related to Lower Providence especially, and it's not an easy decision. And I am not making the decision based on some risk that I'm willing to take with the safety of our children. So from just want to be on the record that that is not the case for my particular vote. I will support this somewhat reluctantly because of our relationship with Lower Providence, but I think that we have the ability to provide at least the same services with additional hours at a much lower cost that we discussed in the budgetary process for this year. So if there is anything that I need to know about in this process before I vote for this, and not just a little bit innuendo, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Any other comment? Okay. All those in favor? 7, those against? 2, so passes by a motion of 7.
There's only one. Brenda voted yes.
Oh,
she voted for it.
You voted for it, Brenda?
Yeah.
I apologize. We voted for 8-1 with Mr. Phillips being the one. Okay, dates for the board's calendar. We have none. Old business, new business. Now we'll have a courtesy of the floor.
I am representing the Special Education Alliance of the MCC.
Can you use your name and where you're from?
I'm
where you
Gina
live.
Stover, and I am in Woodland with a special needs child. So we just had a few questions for you on the presentation that Dr. Anstek gave about the review of the elementary schools and their programs. Just a few, I'm not sure if anything was being addressed at that point, but the presentation gave a current picture of what is going on within the school district right now. Have we taken into consideration the future picture of how will this information be utilized for the future needs of the kids coming into the district or moving up in the schools with needs based upon them and the classrooms that are going to be utilized? That's just one question.
I had that same question.
Oh, okay.
And so my concern was looking at historical trends and where the future trends are, where are needs from the special services. Is it going to grow? Is it going to decrease and everything? So Dr. Angstead and others in reviewing all this have been taking that into account.
Okay. Has this information also been reviewed on an outside basis by like a third party so that we understand that all this documentation is true and correct? Like that? Have we, or has it just been reviewed within the school district ourselves?
The information we're providing, that we provided here this evening and we provided for within the elementary program study is being provided to Milo and McBroom as part of the overall recommendations for the district.
Okay. Is that something that you might possibly look into, doing like a third-party review of that, or?
I'll say that again.
So the documentation was provided by school district. Are we looking into possibly getting it encompassed by the special needs and the total spaces by a third party? You're not understanding.
Yep, Milo and McBroom, the contractor that we have working with us on the school consolidation question, is reviewing all of our information.
Okay. And then in regards to the C, is there any way that we can have anything that's regarding to special needs go through the website so that we're aware? Because we were not properly addressed that this was going to be happening and happening at the board meetings and that kind of stuff. Is there any way that we can move forward with it being addressed and notified to us?
I'm not certain if I can answer your question, but this recent presentation or this evening's presentation was a result of a request at a public meeting. We complied with that and we posted it on the agenda. We posted the presentation, not the presentation itself, but the item to present for this evening, approximately 72 hours before the meeting. We are going to propose posting all this information, any other information that we bring forward, to the district website under the school consolidation area. Ms. Lynch handles that, and we try to provide notice, for example, of meetings, and so we'll be posting those as well. That will be coming up in January and February.
Okay. I do know that this is a very new alliance, so we're not within any communication right now, so we just want to make sure that we're communicating all the special needs to all the parents out there. So, okay, thank you.
Anybody else? John.
John Andrews, Law of Providence. Following up on the prior Lady Gina, with regard to the two presentations on special ed rooms, I find that primarily they're an inventory of the current uses, and we still need information as to the capacities of those rooms in terms of how many autistic children can go into a room, and for instance, and we know nothing about the current utilization of those rooms relative to the capacity. I think that's information that we need, in that we're getting projections of enrollment, and we want to get some confidence in the capacities of the current buildings over a, you know, over a substantial period, 10 years. And also with regard specifically to the K to 4 presentation of a few weeks ago, in terms of the regular room capacities, that had capacities of 25 for K through 4. And you know, it seems like everyone has accepted that for K to 2, the capacity should be 22, not 25. And with regard to this evening's presentation, I think it showed that there's zero home rooms available for undesignated uses at the current time. And just a few years ago, we had 200 more students in the high school. We haven't changed the facilities, so how did we fit 200 more students in 2 years ago, and now we're saying that we have unutilized rooms. Again, with regard to each of these presentations, the numbers at the bottom of each column could easily have been in a readable font. It's one thing to know how to press the button to advance the slides, but we need to have readable presentations, and some of the audience is quite a bit further back in the room, probably three times as far as the front row. So I'm a little disappointed in that regard. And also, I think that we're going to see a lot of schedules slipping when we take the rest of the month off. The school is a full-time business, at least September through half of June for the students. And while there are other things going on at the end of the year, we're going to be missing schedules when we don't have a full set of meetings. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I just want to clarify one thing. I've heard that a couple of times tonight. I don't want anybody to forget about the finance meeting tomorrow night. We are not taking the rest of the month off. We will be meeting tomorrow night. So I just wanted to put that out there. Thank
good,
you.
Good plug, Mike. Anybody else?
And I just would just like to add that Dr. Engstead apologized for the font. There's so much you can do in a spreadsheet, and it will be posted on the website tomorrow so that people can make it bigger. I realize, but I just, you got to give people a break.
Anybody else? Okay. May I have a motion to adjourn the meeting? Second. All those in favor? Thank you, everybody. Have a happy holiday season and enjoy yourselves.